Hi, this is Bruce Rawles, and again I'm speaking with Dr. Robert Rosenthal, who goes by Dr. Bob, who is the co-president of the Foundation for Inner Peace in California, and also an author of a book which I'm very much enjoying, by the way. I'm about halfway through it, called From Plagues to Miracles. And if you haven't checked this book out, you might want to do so, because it's potent and wonderful and can't say enough good things about it. It's basically, as the subtitle says, the transformational journey of Exodus from the slavery of ego to the promised land of spirit. And Bob and I thought it might be interesting to talk about the book. It's Genesis maybe the first half of it, since that's as far as I've gotten through it, focus on that part of it, including the symbolism of Passover and the symbolism of the ego as the Pharaoh and Moses as our inner kindness teacher / Holy Spirit, or whatever we want to call it, share in that context, perhaps with the idea of emphasizing what students of A Course in Miracles might want to discover in a book like this. So thank you, Bob, for being here.
Thank you so much. It's great. We had a good chat the last time, and I'm looking forward to repeating that experience.
Excellent, excellent. So do you want to talk about, what inspired you to write the book?
It's a good story, actually. I mean, the story of the writing of the book, as you said, the genesis of the book about Exodus.
that was an unconscious pun, sort of.
Right, almost. Right. I was born Jewish. I'm still a somewhat practicing Jew. But the only Jewish holiday that really holds any true appeal for me and a real sense of something holy and powerful is the holiday of Passover, which I subsequently learned in writing the book is the first holiday that the Bible prescribes that we should be celebrating and following. It comes before any other. So in 1987, I found myself in a very unhappy situation at work. I was on the psychiatry staff at a hospital in Philadelphia that the year before had been absolutely wonderful. And for reasons I won't go into here, it had just all crashed and burned, and I did not like what was going on. But I saw no way to extricate myself. The guy who was my boss had a reputation for really blackballing anyone who left his division. It had happened to a good friend of mine. And coincidentally, this was all taking place right before the Passover holiday. Through A Course in Miracles, of course, I had learned, I will step back and let him lead the way. So I turned it all over to Holy Spirit. And as things happened to play out, as I like to say, my division chair made me an offer I couldn't accept. And because it came from him, and I turned it down, he couldn't really get mad at me. I mean, he put me in that situation. And I think I turned out to be, the first person leaving the division, not on a stretcher, who actually got feted with a party, and we remained on good terms. And I continued to get referrals from the hospital, and all good.
Nice.
So when I went into the Passover Seder, I couldn't help but notice that the story I had just gone through was very, very parallel to the story of Passover. We're in a stuck place. We're feeling enslaved. We see no way out. And because of the intervention of God and miracles, suddenly we're free. The Red Sea parts. And following the experience, I even had, just a whole series of amazing dreams where obstacles seemed to melt away. So I knew, if my unconscious is jumping on the train here, it was significant. So that was 1987, and I'd always toyed with the idea of Passover. And, circumstances came around in a way that I'm actually writing about in a book that will be coming out next March. Where my career as a screenwriter crashed and burned. And in the wake of that, I was kind of sitting around going, well, I'm a writer, but I don't have anything to write. What should I write? And I led a Passover Seder that year Funny how these things all happen in April. And my wife said, you know, why don't you write a book on that? And I said, okay, sure. And I envisioned, you know, a 50-page book that would be more of a pamphlet that people could leave in their bathrooms and, you know, read in intervals while they were in their bathrooms. And I wrote, and it just kept writing. I got deep into the text of Exodus, found stuff there that just really resonated. A lot of parallels to A Course in Miracles. Finished the book, farmed it out to a couple of friends who were established writers, and got some feedback that said, well, you know, this is all good, but I think this is the book you really want to write. I had an appendix, and I realized they were absolutely right. I also learned that nobody sells a nonfiction book. So if you're writing a nonfiction book and you don't want to self-publish, go back. You need to write a proposal. People sell proposals for nonfiction books. You only need to write three chapters. So I went back and did the whole thing over again. And that was where the idea of looking at the story of Exodus as a parable, as a grand parable, of the spiritual journey back to God, which starts enslaved, hopeless, no way out, and then through the birth of Moses, which I see as the equivalent of both Jesus and Holy Spirit, that within us which knows the way to freedom, but which we still need to, you know, kind of nurture and become more mature about. That were eventually led, you know, out of bondage, but that the path proceeds in some interesting ways. So that's what we're going to be talking about today is, yeah, what is it about Exodus that is so apt and appropriate, not just to Jews, not just to Passover in this time of the year, but to every single one of us. Mm-hmm. So let's start with something that's not in my book. The Hebrew word for Hebrews is iparu, which means wanderers. Now that's been interpreted quite understandably to say, well, the Hebrews were a nomadic tribe. They had no home. They were looking for a home, but they wound up in Egypt and eventually they get to the promised land. But if you think about each one of us and our plight here in the world of form, we are very much wanderers. We're on a journey. A Course in Miracles tells us we can't help but journey because we know that we don't belong here. And so in that sense, I really know that the plight of the Hebrews, wanderers, lost with no home of their own, looking for their true home, is very much what A Course in Miracles is also talking about and the journey that we are all on.
Right. And I think it also admonishes us to look at our particular temporal circumstances as well as spatial as temporary and transient, and that reminds me of one of my favorite two-word quotes from in Gary Renard's second book, Your Immortal Reality. He has the Peirce's Gospel of Thomas, and one of the quotes from that is, "Be passersby."
That's beautiful.
Yeah, and I think that fits beautifully because, you know, we're all wandering, and if we can just kind of see the projected world as the result of a process that we set in motion long before we have any conscious awareness of it, and realize that it's our classroom.
Yeah,
we can not take it quite so seriously, and then the wandering can come to fruition in that homecoming that you describe in your book.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, even if we jump to the end of Exodus, you know, the book doesn't end with the Hebrews entering the promised land. They screw it up because we screwed it up, and we've screwed it up so many times, and I do go into that in the book. Mm-hmm. But I think we're very much in the plight of the Hebrews. We haven't reached there yet. We're not in the real world. The Moses within us can see the real world. The Holy Spirit knows the whole journey ahead of time because it's already been completed. You know, our fate is sealed in that sense. You know, we can't choose the curriculum, but we can elect what we want to take at a given time. Mm-hmm. So the book just is a beautiful rendition of our circumstances. And I actually like to think of it and now describe Exodus as the first Course in Miracles. It had this small problem. There was no love in it. There was no forgiveness. I guess wandering tribes back in, you know, 1300 BCE just didn't do a lot in the way of love and forgiveness, But in terms of looking at attachment, aversion, bondage, slavery, and the role of miracles on the way to freedom, I think it's just a beautiful work.
I do too. In fact, in particular, as I was going through, what really kind of started jumping out at me is the specifics you put in the second chapter, all the different forms of slavery and bondage, the things that we find ourselves investing in. I thought those were the case studies that you gave were just brilliant. You know, bondage to time, bondage to the body, bondage to relationships, bondage to beliefs and values, bondage to roles. And, you know, just those bondage to possessions, just those alone, you know, could fill many books.
Yes.
Money. But in any one of those, and the examples you gave were just brilliant, because I think they really nailed the essence of the thoughts and feelings that accompany those kinds of mental slavery. And so anyway.
Well, the examples were generally taken from people I've worked with in my psychotherapy practice.
I kind of figure that, that you might change a few names to protect the innocent.
Yeah, oh, the names and the circumstances are radically changed. I doubt even the people they're based on would recognize all of them. And in a lot of cases, I've done composites of different people who had, you know, the same kinds of issues. But yeah, the lens of slavery is a useful one.
I think so too.
Yeah. And
very, very relatable examples. Very relatable.
Thank you. I mean, who among us, you know, I mean, the Course tells us anything the ego tells us we need will hurt us, can hurt us, and will do so. Any place where we have a value in the world of form, in the world of illusion that we've identified with, that we think is essential, that is going to make the entire world of illusion real. There's no getting around that. You can't be just a little bit pregnant. You know, you can't cherish one illusion and pretend that all the rest don't matter. You know, it's an all or nothing game. Yeah. But before we talk more about bondage, I just I gave a talk on this at the Miracle Distribution Center in 2012. It was sort of my coming out talk. The book had been out for a few months. And I went through the concordance and looked up all the places that mention enslavement, bondage, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So bondage itself, a mere 15 mentions. Slaves, slavery, enslavement, 44. Chains or chained, 33. Prisoners, prisons, imprisonment, 125. Mm-hmm. Escape in all of its forms, 245. Release or releasing or being released, 322. And then, of course, freedom or free or freed, 637 references.
Wow.
So in total, the Course has over 1,400 references to this idea that we are in some way stuck, bound, imprisoned, and that we want to be free. Mm-hmm. By contrast, there are only 550 references to miracles, which, of course, is also part of this. So, and the guy giving Helen the dictation, Jesus, Jay, would certainly have known all about Exodus. You know, there was no Christian church at the time. There were no gospels. I mean, Exodus would have been his formative gospel, so to speak. Uh-huh. So I don't think it's any coincidence that all of these references are in the Course.
Yeah.
But once we realized, you know, that we're enslaved, what's the way out? And the first thing that, well, you know, I will tend to jump all over. The first thing in Exodus that happens is Moses is born. And it's practically Moses's birth is practically simultaneous with a decree that the Pharaoh issues to have all Hebrew firstborns killed by throwing them in the river. The way I look at this is, you know, the moment our bondage ramps up to a point where it's absolutely untenable, the seeds of our salvation are already there. We may not see it, we may not know it, but they are there. And in, I think that's the third chapter, I look at the idea that Moses is, you know, put in a basket and cast out on the river so that he's saved from this fate of being drowned. And the paradox of, you know, the waters that are supposed to kill you turn out to be the ones that save you. which we see again with the plagues. You know, we'll talk about that in a moment. But the plagues that kill the part of you that is enslaved in Egypt, the pharaohic part of you, turn out to be the miracle that sets you free. So, you know, Moses being set on the water and the idea of a river, which is the epitome of flow. I mean, the river knows where it's going, but where you enter it, you have no idea what that endpoint looks like. You know, there's a level of trust here. There's a level of, all right, I'm going to climb aboard and let me see where I get off.
Kind of reminiscent of the river bottom creature metaphor in Richard Bach's illusions parable at the beginning.
Yes, that's right. I forgot all about that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good call.
Got to let go and trust that the current will take us where it will. Yeah.
We really don't have a choice. I mean, if we fight it and resist it, we're just going to get exhausted and, you know, at some point we surrender. You know, the old tolerance for pain may be high, but it is not without limit. Mm-hmm. Eventually everyone begins to realize, you know, in some way there must be a better way. So Moses, yeah, sorry.
Well, I was just going to say, bounce off of what you just said about the slavery and the bondage and imprisonment and the release and all those words that appear many times in the course, I think one of the things that ties the Exodus metaphors very nicely into the course is an image that I find really helpful frequently when I remember it anyway, is the idea that you know, the ego represents a prison. And, you know, metaphorically, and the Holy Spirit, or our inner kindness teacher, or the Jesus of the course, becomes essentially a classroom, but it uses the same bricks to build kind of structure. It's the same specifics that we are confronted with, the same plagues, if you will, when we turn them around, become the things that free us and liberate our minds. You know, but it's those specifics that become the classroom.
I think that really is the beauty of A Course in Miracles and the beauty of understanding, you know, the reinterpretation of the world of form. Because we are still, you know, the oneness that we were created to be and nothing else, and we've hallucinated this, you know, nightmare factory of ego and form, reality doesn't go away. But we can choose to see it as real, or we can allow it to be, you know, reinterpreted for us in a way that, as you say, becomes a classroom rather than a prison. Mm-hmm. And what a difference, you know, if you're in a prison, you're in trouble. You know, we have a problem.
Not fun. Yeah, exactly.
Not fun in a classroom. I mean, I guess it's sort of a difference between the traditional church doctrine of hell versus purgatory that Dante made such a big deal of. If you're in hell, give up, you know, you're there forever, it's going to be horrible.
Abandon all hope,
you enter.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and that dovetails with the idea of sin and, you know, sin being permanent, which the Course is so wonderful. And it's like, mm-hmm. you know, there is no sin, there's only error, and error is always open to correction. If you're in a classroom, you're learning, it can all be corrected.
Yeah, that is such a hugely helpful concept. And I remember when I first, you know, the first few months of picking up A Course in Miracles back in the mid-80s, I was actually backpacking in the California Sierras. And I have now what I call my backpacking edition, very dog-eared, literally falling apart. But I was going through it for the first, you know, the first few times. And I, when I got to one of the you know, parts in the text where it was talking about the difference between sin and error, it was like, that makes so much sense. You know, sin is this unforgivable, untenable, unfathomable, irreconcilable, you know, oops that can't be corrected. Whereas error is just like, okay, I can back my little car out of the cul-de-sac and, yes. and get back on the thoroughfare. You know, I don't have to drive endlessly around in the cul-de-sac saying, woe is me.
Yeah, you made a wrong turn.
Exactly. It's forgivable. Yeah.
Yep. Now, you know, playing off that metaphor, I would say, unfortunately, the ego is more like a guy than a woman, because the ego refuses to ask for help. And will just keep driving around the cul-de-sac, going, and getting angrier and angrier. Uh-huh. And put up that darn sign anyway.
Really?
Whereas, you know, the anima, the female in us, will go, no, let's ask for help. And when we ask for help, lo and behold, the help arrives and we find our way out of the cul-de-sac.
Yeah, I think there's a lot to that, actually.
Yeah, I do too. So one, apropos of that, one of the things in Exodus that often gets overlooked is, what is it that takes place that starts the ball rolling toward freedom? And, you know, I would never have known this, but on a very close reading, what you see is, you know, the Hebrews, the wanderers, are stuck in Egypt. The Hebrew word for Egypt, by the way, is Mitzrayim, which means a tight, constricted place, a cul-de-sac, you know, a place you can't get out of, which I think is just a lovely description for the world of ego.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so they're stuck in Mitzrayim, there's groaning and gnashing of teeth and all that, and they don't know how to get out. But then they call on God. I think it's at the end of chapter 2 of Exodus, and God hears them. And the significant thing here is that until you call out, until you realize that you need help, you can suffer, and no, God doesn't hear you because you're in an illusion. You know, God knows you as the oneness that you are. It's not that anyone wants to inflict pain. It's just that we have to get to that point where we ask for help. You know, we ask for directions. What is the way out? And Exodus makes that very clear. The moment they call out, God, quote, remembers his covenant with the people. Well, he never forgot. Mm-hmm. It's just that, you know, it's a two-way street. God can't intervene until we reach out, because that would be imposing on free will. And that would make the illusion real. You know, the moment God enters the illusion, it's real, because God is the epitome of reality.
Exactly.
But when we wake up or go, all right, I think I'm having a bad dream. I mean, I don't know if you've had that experience, Bruce. I have, where in the middle of a bad dream, something shifts and you just go, wait a minute. I'm pretty sure this is a dream. And immediately it all starts going in a different direction.
It's funny you should mention, because I had years ago, probably two or three decades ago, a recurring nightmare of being chased by this hooded figure with a long sword or saber. And it was very terrifying. And I would, you know, flee for my life over and over again. And finally, one night while I was having this dream, I'd been beginning to study metaphysical things and read about lucidity. And I had this lucid dream where I realized, wait a minute, this is my dream. And in this nocturnal dream, I turned around, confronted this hooded assailant. I don't think I ever really saw the face under the hood, but I grabbed the sword, snapped it in two over my knee and said, don't ever do that again. And I never had the dream again.
I love it.
So yes, as a matter of fact, funny you should mention, I can totally relate to that. Yes.
Yeah. So you have to be aware in order to realize that it's a dream, and then you face right. The horrors that you created, that you made in the dream, to use the course's term, and then we can deal with them. Very Jungian. By the way, there's Ursula Le Guin, the science fiction fantasy writer, in her book A Wizard of Earthsea, has exactly that dilemma where the main character, who's an archmage, an amazing magician, casts a spell that just like rips the world asunder, and this dark shadow starts chasing him all over. And after running and running and running and running, he finally reaches the point where he realizes he has to turn around and face it. And he looks at it and he speaks its name, which of course is his name. And the two join and it is no more. Mm-hmm. And he goes on to the next book where he's much wiser.
yeah. And I think not long after that dream, I was, you know, struck with the symbolism in the Star Wars epics where you know, Luke confronts his father, you know, and the whole authority problem, you know, symbolism and all that kind of stuff. And so, you know, symbols are everywhere if we're willing to look for them, aren't they? Yeah.
Yeah, they are. And, you know, speaking of Darth Vader, the ultimate bad father, this is very similar to the portrait of God that shows up in Exodus and in the Old mm-hmm. Testament. Mm-hmm. And I think it's one of the reasons why people have such a hard time, you know, with the story, because, yeah, that's God. Who wants any part of it?
Exactly.
But I,
yeah, and have, you bring that out in your book nicely. Is this is that you know if and the God that we usually identify with is certainly if we are unconsciously you know adopting the premises of our religious upbringing is a very schizophrenic God, and why would we want to you know mature into that?
Well, I think that is the God that we create in our image.
Exactly.
You know, the
exactly.
God of ego. Take all of the worst characteristics of ego, amplify them to, you know, their ultimate, and you get an angry God, a jealous God, a God who demands that you, you know, worship him here, there. But so the portrait we're getting is kind of a false God, but the story itself unfolds in a way that gets us past that. And, you know, as long as we're on the topic, the tip-off is that that's not the God that Moses sees. I mean, Moses goes up on the mountain and hangs out for 30 days, and they're having these wonderful conversations. You know, Moses even says, I'd like to see your face. And God says, well, that's not possible. But I'll tell you what, how about I hide you in a rock, and as I go by, you can sort of, you know, touch me and see me that way. I mean, it's a totally different portrait of God. Mm-hmm. When we approach the ego's version of God from Moses, the Moses mind, the Holy Spirit, the perspective of the Course, we don't get that thunder and lightning stuff. But when the Hebrew people get to Mount Sinai, that's exactly what they get because they're not prepared. Mm-hmm. They haven't learned you know, the lessons. The Course tells us, you know, miracles are everyone's right, but purification is necessary first. Purification just means that process of freeing yourself from the things you're enslaved to so that, you know, you're a clear through line, a clear channel, you know, that they can work the miracles through you and you're not getting in the way.
When you mentioned purification, when I was putting this book together on the Hermetic laws and smattering of a Course in Miracles and sacred geometry and whatnot, the fourth of the seven Hermetic laws is the law of polarity, and the word that came to mind that's sort of a keystone word there or a keynote word is purity, and I was started thinking about purity in the content on the context of inclusion. And then when you think of something, you know, a fabric or a substance or you know, some quantity of something that's pure, it's not tainted or contaminated with other stuff. And I was thinking, well, that's really a kind of a fitting metaphor for the thought system of inclusion is pure because it includes everyone as the same, not necessarily on the level of form, but on the level of mind. Whereas the impure is basically saying, well, there's a we and a they. There's differences are more important than sameness, and ever since then, whenever I hear the word pure or purity, I think, well, gee, there's a reminder that I need to look at my thought system. Is it either inclusive or exclusive? So
that's a great insight. I mean, in that sense, the ability to see impurity implies a judgment, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, if we're using Christ's vision and we're just seeing that light behind every face, there's no impurity in that light. You know, the impurity shows up when we start making judgments and looking at what's different rather than what's the same.
Exactly.
I mean, one of the points I've been trying to put forward a lot with all of the various editions of A Course in Miracles that are out there, including, you know, the new Circle of Atonement one, is if we're honest, the similarities vastly, vastly outweigh differences. I mean, you've got to dig in to find what's different. And sure, there are differences, but use any one of them, and you know you're on the journey. You're going to get there.
Right. It'd be hard to not notice that the inspiration behind the words, even though the form may be a little different.
Yeah. And you know, as the Course says, words are symbols of symbols. I mean, how seriously should we take them?
Exactly. Kind of back to that people's front of Judea versus Judean people's front schism.
Yeah, right.
I love that Life of Brian,
right.
Because it just to me epitomizes the silliness of the ego's, you know, insistence on making differences a big deal, you know.
Well, that's, you know, one of the things that I think we all have to realize is we start the journey by focusing on specific aspects of our lives and we start making changes there and we don't understand the idea yet, as the Course talks about, of the generalizability of the teaching. And in fact, you know, I think it's one of the last of the steps of trust in the teacher's manual and the teacher of God, when the teacher of God realizes that it's applicable to absolutely everything in her or his life. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we start in these confined areas, but at some point we realize we're the ones looking for the differences. We're the ones making the judgments. And we think that's salvation. And when you realize that, no, dude, that's messing me up, there's the path, you know, to freedom, mm-hmm. right there.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Those that, and we praise and glorify and reward in our culture that ability to discern, and we call that wisdom. And
yes.
And you know, obviously you have to do quite a bit of that in order just to get by in the world on a practical, you know, what the world calls practical basis. But if we have an awareness that doesn't have to mean that we divide people into two camps, you know.
Well, it's what we're taught. One of there was a psychologist in the very first Course in Miracles group I ever belonged to, back in Philadelphia in, you know, the mid to late 70s. And, you know, she said, look, you got to have an ego to lose an ego. Mm-hmm. Now, that wasn't talking about ego in the Course sense. That was, you know, talking more psychologically and psychoanalytically. But in a sense, yeah, you have to be able to read the Course and understand it. You have to be able to think about how to apply it. You know, I've worked with schizophrenics, for example, whose ego structure in that sense was very weak. They're so terrified, it's very hard to stabilize anything. So sometimes the first step is let's address the fear, and sometimes you've got to move in a paradoxical direction, mm-hmm. that doesn't look spiritual on the outside, but in fact is.
Right.
You know, I at a later point in From Plagues to Miracles, I refer to a woman I worked with who suffered horrific abuse. And I don't think I go into all the details in the book, but, you know, she and I spent 6 months where she would very graphically castrate one of her abusers and do terrible things to his member, which sure doesn't sound terribly holy or, you know, like what you would want to prescribe, but it was exactly what she needed to do. And at a certain point, it was kind of like, okay, I'm done with that. I don't need to do that. And I'm not even mad at him anymore. And in fact, you know what? I can forgive it. And I see where he was coming from. You know, the path there can be very different, and it's very easy to judge. Well, that's not holy. I can't see, you know, how can anyone say that or do that? But we can never really stand in the shoes of another. So, you know, all we can do is take care of our own self, you know, pay attention to our soul function, which is accepting the atonement for ourself, and trust that when we do that, we're also accepting it for everybody else. Mm-hmm. It's holographic.
It is. It is. Yeah. Ripples in dimensions and realms that I'm certain not aware of at all. Yeah. Like it says.
But the ego does try to handle things on its own. In the story of Exodus, mm-hmm. this is symbolized by the sections on Pharaoh's magicians, where, all right, you know, Moses goes into Egypt, which, you know, the elevator pitch for the book would basically be Pharaoh is ego, Moses is Holy Spirit, and the seeming conflict between them is your journey home. So, you know, Moses, Jesus, the good part of your mind that never left God, goes into the realm of ego, which is where we're all living and enslaved, and says, set my people free, you know, let my people go, I think the song is. Mm-hmm. And of course, ego goes, no way. Pharaoh says, no, I'm not going to do that. All right, so here's your first plague. Now, the plague isn't punishment. The plague is feedback. The plague says, if you're using this particular thought system of enslavement, things are not going to go terribly well. And the first plague is Moses, through God, of course, turns all the water in Egypt into blood. But then Exodus says, Pharaoh's magicians came up and they did the exact same thing. So Pharaoh was singularly unimpressed and didn't budge in letting the people go free. But here's the deal. If God turned all the water in Egypt into blood, then what water would have been left for Pharaoh's magicians to change to blood?
Right. You know, I remember reading that. Good point. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, the second plague was this infestation of frogs. And, you know, and they say the same thing. The frogs are coming up. But then Pharaoh's magicians did the same thing. And I asked the question, well, you know, if the Nile River is belching frogs from its bank nonstop and Pharaoh's magicians step forward and go, let there be frogs. Well, why is that, you know, a miracle duplicating gods? You know, Pharaoh's magicians piggyback on the miracle of God and try, therefore, to disguise it and convince us that it's there's nothing there.
It's kind of like the ego's classic Me Too substitute thinking, right?
Yeah, I'm thinking of some movie, it might have been Monty Python, where, you know, don't pay any attention to that man over there. No, Wizard of Oz.
Wizard of Oz, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, the curtain goes back and the grand and imposing wizard says, pay no mind to, you know, that's what the ego, the Pharaoh's magicians do. And ultimately, it's the idea that we don't need God. We can accomplish what we want on our own. And I think in the world of technology in particular, this is a real temptation. You know, we'll figure it out on our own. We'll find an app that'll do it. We'll contact our 5,000 friends on social media. One of them will surely have a good idea that will get us out of bondage. No, it doesn't work that way.
Yeah, it's really tempting to think that we can do it on our own. And but even in the business world, you know, when you look at what works, even on a pragmatic sense, inevitably it's the companies and the corporations and the nonprofits that reach out and collaborate and learn how to you know, look in terms of what is in everyone's best interest and you know, the shared interest ideal. That turns things around for people and groups of people. So
yeah, I mean, what does the course say? The lonely journey fails because it has excluded what it would find. You know, you can't find it if you conceptualize self as an ego in a body that then sets out, you know, holding up a light in the darkness, trying to find some. You've already excluded what you find because it's not there in your concept of self. Yeah. I actually think that's one of the most difficult things about A Course in Miracles. That is very, the hardest thing for the ego to accept is that it's unreal and it needs to let go. And I don't think new students should have to do that. I think the Holy Spirit's curriculum is very gentle. It will lead you and us at exactly the right pace. But at some point, I'll tell you, you know, ego starts feeling pretty fuzzy and unreal, and your physical body starts feeling pretty fuzzy and unreal. There's a line, I think it's in the introduction to part two of the workbook, that talks about reality or truth shimmering on the wide horizons of our mind. I'm paraphrasing. But I think it's just so beautiful because by that point, or at some point, yeah, our mind feels like it's pretty wide and those horizons, you know, there's just that light shimmering at the edges that says you're on the right track.
Mm-hmm. That's a nice reminder, isn't it? You know, we do get feedback and we do get the reminders that when we choose against the Pharaoh's thought system, so to speak, you know, we do find little bits of respite from the plagues and miracle moments where the peace is restored because we just finally say, okay, enough of this. Enough of this. Dualistic thinking.
I mean, go ahead.
Oh, I was just gonna say earlier when we were talking about the we, they thing, I was reminded of years ago before the internet, and I was working in an office where people would photocopy humorous things and pass them around. And there was this sheet that had all these sub-laws of Murphy's Law, which is, of course, if anything can go wrong, it will. You know, that's the basic maxim of the ego, if you want to think of it that way. But there was another one that was, I thought, really a very Zen Cohen-like sub-law of Murphy's Law, and it was called Garth's Distinction. And Garth's Distinction goes, there are two types of people in the world, those who divide people into two types and those who don't. So anyway, But I thought that's just a perfect example of, you know, the conundrum of the ego of thinking that, you know, there's always got to be some division that will keep its thought system intact, and you know, and it's dead set toward finding it. And but the promised land is really beyond that dualistic thinking, isn't it?
Yeah. And you know, as you were saying before, once we bring it in, you know, once we bring illusions to the truth, they, you know, miracles happen, things shift. You know, I mean, if someone asked what is the central point of Exodus in terms of the spiritual path, I would say it is the idea that we read the plagues and we go, well, how could any loving God do that and inflict that on people? But if you shift and go, all right, the Egyptians aren't really people in a parable. They symbolize something in our mind, and they symbolize, you know, the fruits of ego and the world that ego sees. Then how could, you know, Holy Spirit, as it were, not cause some conflict so that we notice that all is not well, you know, and do something about it. And in that sense, I mean, in Exodus, truly, every plague is a step on the way to freedom for the Hebrew people. Mm-hmm. They don't happen where the Hebrews live. And it's only the 10th plague where they even have to take any action to protect themselves from the angel of death. Otherwise, you know, they're just sort of hunkered down in the land of Goshen, you know, having dinner, watching TV, while, you know, these horrors happen, you know, around the corner in Egypt. But it's, you can't read it as real life. It's a parable. Yeah. So in our minds, I mean, if at the first plague the Pharaoh had gone, gosh, you just turned everything into blood, water, you know, that which is life into that which, you know, is death, or, you know, I think I'm going to let the people go. I think you're right. I think I want to join you. Then, great. But that's not how the ego operates. And therefore, the story of Exodus, which we will, you know, tell on Passover in a few days, and if you're watching this archived, every day is Passover in that sense. The story of Exodus makes the point that it's not until the 10th plague, when the firstborns of Egypt are slain, Pharaoh's children, but the first, you know, the first children of the cattle, of the house cats, of all the slaves except the Hebrews. And this feels incredibly punitive and terrible until you ask, well, what would the firstborns of ego be? All the things we cherish most and refuse to turn over to Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. You know, Holy Spirit, you know, yeah, you know, take the hardships from me, but I still want my sensual massage, or I really love watching the news and, you know, seeing my favorite political characters get their comeuppance. They're places that we still hold on to. And the 10th plague says, there's no compromise. You get rid of it all. Or as the famous editor Maxwell Perkins said about Thomas Wolfe's work, you know, murder your darlings. If you cherish it and it's in the world of form, you'd better take another look. And in the metaphor of Exodus, it needs to die. Mm-hmm. Of course, it's not really death, because there is no death. It's you releasing it.
Yeah. Seems like there's a lot of Eastern mysticism that corroborates with that, of, you know, looking at you know, the Maya, or illusion of the self, and realizing that, you know, we have to be willing to relinquish that and know that, and trust that the reality of the inclusion that the curriculum of the Holy Spirit presents is really one of complete freedom and complete liberation from that slavery.
And happiness.
Yeah. It's peaceful. It's actually kind of nice.
Yeah. And you can't get there, you know, without taking that path.
Exactly.
So if you're identified with ego and think ego is going to bring you happiness, which it can, you know, for a short time, temporarily, but ultimately there's the loss. And even if you live an absolutely charmed life, at some point people are going to start dying and you're going to get older. And, you know, this was the great insight that the Buddha had when, you know, when he left the palace. He discovered illness, aging, and death, the three, you know, inevitables of life in a body, and said there must be a better way, and he set out to find it. Anyway, I lost my train of thought there.
Oh, so. I'll continue with what you just reminded me of then. And that is in the last chapter of the text in A Course in Miracles, one of my favorite sections is the real alternative, which to me sort of is summarized by the, you know, paraphrasing, like, you think you might want to try everything on your bucket list, you know, until you finally exhausted all the permutations of ego's, you know, temptations and carrots on a stick kind of thing. But well, maybe you don't have to do that. Maybe you don't have to try every, you know, unfulfilling and ultimately unsatisfying attempt to try to make the world work for you, and retire your, you know, recovering dream repair technician hat and take that off and say, well, okay, maybe I can, you know, find a truth and a reality to the identity that we all share. That is more fulfilling than all the set things we try to do separately on our own. And so anyway, I find that particular section really inspiring, especially when you look at all the things that we try over and over and over to make work. You know, it's like, oh gosh, can I give it a rest?
I think that might be one of the few sections where I have the entire thing underlined and boxed and starred. I mean, that is a real gem. Yeah,
it is.
I mean, what I would say is, I think before you can get enlightened, you need to have a special relationship with every single person on the planet. How's that? Think about how incredibly arduous, daunting that would be to go through, oh, I've just fallen in love with that one and that one and that one. And oh, they didn't turn out to be who I thought they were. And they're not going to rescue me from all of my problems and sacrifice their life for mine or accept my sacrifice for, you know. You don't need to do that. One relationship held properly will suffice.
Yes.
Maybe three or four, and you know. And
that learning to generalize, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
And I think that's the beauty of what you put in your book too, is we can take the seemingly specific example of the nation, if you will, of the Hebrews and the nation of the Egyptians, which kind of represent our thoughts and feelings, you know, large conglomerations of thoughts of two thought systems, and realize that one is totally insane and one is totally sane symbolically, and not picking on those geographically or culturally, but really as metaphors. And we can, you know, extrapolate and generalize and realize this, like you say, this applies to everyone, regardless of their familiarity with the Old Testament or Exodus or anything else. It's really just a universal parable and a you know, a completely applicable story to everyone's you know, search for happiness, isn't it?
Exactly. And in fact, in the Passover Seder, probably for me, the most significant line is the line in, there's a prayer book called the Haggadah that's used, that says, you know, Passover should be celebrated in the present tense, not a commemoration of an event that happened, you know, 3,300 years ago or whatever. It's still happening. Right. Now, most Jews interpret that as, yeah, there's still, you know, people aren't free in the world and it's our job to set them free. And I couldn't agree more, although I might disagree with how we go about that, because trying to free someone through a political process or a revolution, I mean, how many times have we seen that, you know, wind up backfiring? you know, you free others by freeing yourself, and that's the only way it works. But it's celebrated in the present tense. It's applicable at all times, in all places, to all peoples. And that's why I say it's the first Course in Miracles.
Yeah.
And we needed a second one, because I think people didn't get it and misinterpreted it. And, you know, but here, there it is. And
the maybe in another millennium or two, we'll need yet another, you know, who knows?
Yeah, I hope not.
really. So I think we're coming up on about an hour.
We're
so
almost there.
Is there anything else that you want to share? Because there's so much in this, and like I say, I've only gone about halfway through the book so far, and eagerly await reading the rest of it. Are there any other key points in particularly the first half of the book that you might want to share that people would find helpful?
You know, I think if I had to, you know, put a yellow highlight around anything, it would be that idea of don't fear the seeming negatives that come up in your life, because each one is an opportunity. You know, several places in A Course in Miracles, it basically says, you know, from what you want, God will not save you. The Holy Spirit isn't going to stop your lessons because he knows that's the only way it proceeds. Mm-hmm. So, and in particular, if an issue keeps showing up, you know, if you keep going out with men who turn out to be serial killers, you know.
Usually that's a short lived experience, though, right?
Right, you keep escaping, you know. No. In order to but no, seriously, if you know, if that repetitive dream you talked about seems to play out in various forms in quote unquote real life, mm-hmm. that's a learning opportunity. Mm-hmm. And so what seems to be a plague turns out to be a miracle. Somewhere in there I quote a William Blake line that says, you know, I wish I could just flip open to it. You know, under every grief and pine, you know, stands a joy. I mean, it's just a great line that essentially says, you know, when you take that which you're grieving and upset about and really dive into it, it turns out to be a miracle. Mm-hmm. And that to me is the most powerful experience. Now, you know, there's a lot of, I mean, Exodus really tracks very closely with the spiritual journey. And I think the chapter on the wilderness is incredibly important, because I think we often do reach a place where we've divested from ego sufficiently, but we haven't yet been able to kind of run spirit's operating system consistently. Mm-hmm. And there's this very powerful existential sense of, what am I? What am I supposed to do? I don't get it. You know, I'm not getting the joy that I used to get from the things of this world. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's the wilderness. And it's important to understand it so that we can at least know, yeah, this is a phase. And if you've made it that far, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, that might also connect with the fifth stage in the development of trust in the manual for teachers.
Yes, very much so. Yeah.
Because yeah. That's sort of like, okay, I kind of got the hang of at least intellectually of getting that it has to be about inclusion, shared interest, forgiveness, and but that still that this individual self that's doing the forgiving.
Precisely.
And ultimately, that individual self is the stumbling block that we need to let go of, and that's the last bastion of the ego that you know may take a long time. But then I love how the concluding part of that paragraph says, we're not each step so heavily reinforced, and I'm paraphrasing that, you know, it would be a difficult thing indeed, you know, but we do get the reinforcement. We do get if the feeling isn't right, if we are the least bit uncomfortable, that's our clue. That's our little mini plague that kind of gets us back on track, isn't it?
Exactly. Well, there's no order of difficulty in plagues, and there's no order of difficulty in miracles.
Exactly.
There's no order in relationships. I mean, this is, the beauty of the non-dual system, which, yeah, can be very, very difficult to grasp. If it's not understandable intellectually, and I think for many people it really is a reach, eventually your experience in doing the workbook lessons will, at least for me, brings you to a place where you have an experience of that non-duality, of that oneness, that then allows the course to sort of suddenly pop up into, you know, 7 dimensions, 10 dimensions, and now you're really kind of taking it in at a different level. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I mean, I look at a novel I wrote in the 1990s, so I would have been a course student for almost, you know, for over 15 years at that point. And there were things in there in the course that I was still rejecting. And no, you know, it's got to be this way. Yeah.
I can totally relate to that, because when I picked up Gary Renard's book about 10 years ago, I realized, wow, there's a whole bunch of really fundamental ideas in A Course in Miracles that I just totally, you know, zoned out on, you know, and having read through it several times, even, you know, it's like, that was in there? Yeah. Holy moly. So, yeah.
But that's okay. You know, we get what we need when we're ready, and I guess, you know, that little willingness. You don't have to do anything. You just need to be willing to have something happen.
Exactly. Exactly. We all will get to it eventually, you know, and so we don't need to really be too concerned about the timing and just continue on and you know.
As I'm fond of saying, we have all the time in the world, literally. That's all that it's for.
Exactly. Exactly. Anything else you'd like to share, Bob? Or
no, that feels pretty good. Okay. You know, blessings to everyone. And, you know, we're all making the same journey.
Exactly. Likewise. Well, thank you so much. I've been speaking with Dr. Bob Rosenthal, and we've been talking about A Course in Miracles and his wonderful book, From Plagues to Miracles, which you can get on Amazon and various places like that. And I highly recommend it. Good stuff.
Thank you.
So until next time, thank you, and blessings to all, and we'll talk again soon.